Hi and welcome. So I've gone through this earlier also, the HR analytics or the attrition prediction basically for the IBM data set that's been given, the sample data set of Watson Analytics. And now it's much more, I'll upload this file, but before I do that on GitHub, I'm just going through this quick video. So basically step one, feature reduction. So we wanted to do feature reduction, but we've not necessarily done that. Dropped a few features which are absolutely redundant, were not helping us out, so that is one. The other is factor analysis and PCA. Again, defined what it is, and I've actually done the PCA. I have not retained that code, and it's not part of the main pipeline because it's not necessarily required. So PCA got dropped. And yes, to be done, there could be advanced methods of PCA that we will probably do later on to see if we can do a decent feature reduction with PCA on categorical variables. So that is one. The next is the pre-processing of the data. Of course, pre-processing is required. Now, for some of the algorithms that we'll use, only the features, which is the train part, which is the X, so to say, would be required to be pre-processed or scaled or standardized. And for others, we would also have to standardize and scale and pre-process the Y. So any which ways. So for so that entire flow is there. So if you go down in the notebook, you'll see that flow. So this is what I have. So this step five is what is of most interest to me as of now. So choosing the classifiers and moving from one classifier to the other and seeing as to how the accuracy improves, whether it improves or it doesn't improve, and what all is happening. So that is basically it. So logistic regression done, of course, that was a basic one. Did not get very nice results, getting accuracy levels somewhere about 85-86%, whereas 83 is the split of the actual data set. So that's the split of the classes, the dominant class, and so that is the 0 and the 1, the exits from the organization and the ones who stayed back the live. So the k nearest neighbor, yes, of course, did get better scores, but not necessarily what is desired. So naive Bayes, it was done, but it was dropped. So all this, the entire code is here. And the neural networks, the neural networks I'm not very, very comfortable with. There are multiple reasons for that. Firstly, the neural networks have been implemented with Python very, very recently. Then there are a lot of things which are can't be done, this can't be done, that can't be done. There's a lot of ifs and buts over there. So yes, with the same data set, I'll probably try and do R neural network. So that I'll do, and I've done neural networks earlier also, so shouldn't be a hassle, we can do that. And then of course the support vector machine is to be done with Python, of course. The decision tree, I've already kind of done that partially, is what I want to share. So that is basically the reason I'm doing this video. For the decision tree. And then of course random forest, XGBoost, Teapot, and other things. Some of these things I'm not even familiar with as of now. So XGBoost and random forest, okay. AdaBoost and all, okay, fine, I've done that in R, but Teapot and other these things I'll be learning myself. And let's see, this is a good data set to begin all of that with. Okay, perfect. So model evaluation. So classification accuracy is what is the primary concern. Besides that, there is the area under the curve, the ROC curve. So those are two statistics that we'll look at, classification and AUC, ROC. Then again, probably look at Excel worksheets and R parallel projects and other things that we can do. So any which way, so skipping through all of this. The first one, you run this, just load it up, load up the data set. You again go through the categorical variables and you change them. This could also be done with label encoder. Label encoder I have not necessarily explored. I should have done that actually. So the interim DFs, you create some interim DFs. And so this plot is there just for the reason so that we can see that there's a lot of variance. So there's a whole lot of variance. So somebody, but the feature monthly rate has got its mean somewhere here in the middle, which is somewhere around 15,000. And of course, the monthly income has got its mean somewhere around, or the average somewhere around 5,000. Whereas the daily rate has got its mean somewhere around 10 or 15 or something. And the rest of them, they aren't even getting plotted because, of course, those are categorical variables. So this data set definitely is asking for standardization and scaling. So that is the reason I've basically put this plot over here, and nothing fancy. Again, you could look at the density plot. Again, nothing which is not expected. So it's not revealing anything to us. But yes, so there's not much inference drawn like I've written over here, so which is okay. Now, next, this we've already seen earlier in my earlier video, converted the data frames into NumB arrays, and that got done. And of course, the random seed. Now, this I had not covered in my earlier video. So now what is basically happening is, with stratified shuffle split, which is what we are using for ensuring that we have cross-validation, or we have a data set wherein the values which are given in the X train and the Y train and the X and the Y test and the Y train don't necessarily get repeated. So those values remain distinct for as many data sets that we want to create. And how do we ensure that? We ensure that by this random state over here. So this random state, you can put a value of 1, 2, 3, you can put a value of 0, 1, whatever. So it's just basically seeding a random seed. So that's what it is. And with this, we ensure that those values aren't the same. So if you are more comfortable checking those values in a CSV, you can download those CSVs and check those values and see for yourself. Perfect. So going down. So this is basically, again, just showing as to what will be the plot like before and after the scaler, nothing much. Then the Gaussian naive Bayes, not done that. This data set is not necessarily giving good results with the naive Bayes. Multinominal, not possible. We got negative values. So anyways, I have detailed all of that over here. You can go through this. Then pre-processing done, okay, fine. Standard, firstly we did a scalar, then we did a standard scalar. So all those values are down here. You can have a look at those values. Those got printed out. And then of course this neural network, I'll come back to this. I have not tuned it properly yet. It's just giving a 84% accuracy. I'm not even sure if this is the best possible. I'll come back to this and naive Bayes again, and I'll skip the KNN because KNN I had covered earlier. So I'm just going through the flow, and this is the model evaluation. So this was not presented earlier. So this gives a very clear picture of as to 83.88 is the actual presence of the feature, the target variable. So the attrition and this thing, it's the two classes are divided such. So attrition is 83.88%. The live is 83.88% of the data set. So what we want is, if we want something to predict attrition, it should have a much better accuracy score than 83.88%. So that is basically the point. And random state seed value, we had 124 for the non-PCA data set. So I initially did a PCA for which I have given this one, which says PCA data set. So these are the values for that. The rest of it is non-PCA. So PCA was dropped. And with seed value 124, we have got accuracy of 94.33%. And with the seed value of 123, we had accuracy of 95%, so which was much better. So that's slight differences between the data sets. And now this is what I want to look at now, especially for folks who would want their algorithms to be more intuitive. The decision tree is definitely something which is a good classifier. And I had a decision tree fit with depth one. So that depth one and the criteria as entropy in place of the Gini index. And had Depth one hardly got anything, just got three boxes, or rather one tree with two leaves. So that didn't make any sense. So okay, max depth gone to 10, and this is what we have. So I've gone ahead and printed a PDF of that, and this is what we can look at. So if you look at this, very clearly it starts splitting on top with overtime. On one side, it splits to total working years, and on the other side, it goes to monthly income. Then again, from monthly income, it splits down to daily rate, then the education field and the stock option levels. And on the other side, it splits down to the stock option levels, then the monthly income. So over here, with depth of 10, there could be chances of overfitting. There's definitely a likelihood of overfitting. And if you look at the entropy scores are quite high. So let's look at these two as an example. For this one, it says entropy 0.9928, and whereas on the right side for total working years, it says entropy 0.3845. And if you look at the split of the values which are there, the 20 samples which are there, the two classes are 11 and 9 over here, which is like almost, the 9 and 11 are not very distant numbers. And whereas on the other side, you have 31 and 382. So this is the kind of split that we are actually looking at. So we would want to look at entropy numbers which are of less value in place of entropy numbers which are of higher value. So entropy less than say 0.50 is what we should be looking at when we look at the decision tree. So this is as far as the decision tree and what I wanted to share as of now. So probably let's look at different depths and other things. And of course, I'm publishing this straight away. So in case anybody wants to have a look at the earlier things which you had done, can have a look at that also. The entire results for other algorithms are there, but then that's not exciting enough. So as we are getting closer to more accuracy and better predictions, we'll look at the rest of the algorithms. Thanks.